Hello, everyone. I'm Michael Carter. Welcome to the Arizona Deliverance Center. A couple quick announcements. Julie's Zoom, women only, Monday nights, 6:30. Email Brother Mike. He'll give you that code for that. And jump on that one. Tuesday nights, women's only in the sanctuary. I think there's only going to be one more, if I'm not mistaken. I think that's either one or two more. But it's going to be in that small sanctuary. I think Brother Mike, you might join for one of those. I'm not sure on that one for sure yet. But join that. That's women only at 6:30 as well. Rick and Stephanie Zoom call. That's at 6 p.m. Rick does a powerful teaching for about an hour, and then they cast demons out in that. That Zoom call's anointed. I also do a Zoom call on Saturday nights. If you guys ever want information for that at 6 p.m., just email Brother Mike. He'll send you the link for that one. There's no passcode on that ever either. That's at 6 p.m. on Saturdays. Bro Mike's teachings on Fridays, same time, 7 o'clock. We got Children's Deliverance coming up this Saturday. Please bring your preteens. It's geared towards preteens and younger children for deliverance. So please join us for that. That's going to be at 10 a.m. in that small sanctuary. Also, so if you know anybody that needs to be delivered, any kids that need to be delivered or get prayer, receive prayer, my wife's going to be teaching that. She's going to do a small teaching first, and then we'll get into the prayer if anybody wants it. So check out the website at Hardcore Christianity for the events. Everything for the events is coming up. They're doing a couple of out-of-town different churches and stuff like that. So check that calendar for those events. Also, we got the offering boxes in the back. Thank you guys for all your donations. Really appreciate it. Everything's free here. All the money goes back into the ministry. So we're very grateful for everything that you do. If the Lord puts it on your heart, please give. The only thing I had today to add was I just went to the dentist yesterday, and I had this thing called a deep cleaning, and the Lord kind of showed me all that kind of ties in with deliverance in some ways, right? I used to hate going to the dentist, and when I got this deep cleaning this time, I didn't dread it, you know. I didn't dread it. I had all this fear of dentists before, but it was like this time I just wanted to go in there and get it done. But if anybody's ever done that, it's not pleasant at all. You want to make sure you're going each time, each 6 months, and continually getting that plaque off your teeth. When that plaque gets deep into your gums, they got to shoot you with Novocaine, and your face is going to be all messed up, and they got to pull all that plaque off. It takes hours to do that. It's nasty. But the way that he showed me, it was like, that's like deliverance, right? The process of deliverance. You got to pull the slivers out before you can get healed. So it's like pulling that plaque from the teeth, right? It's not a fun process when they're drilling away or pulling and scraping, and you can't. It's a nasty process, but we all got to go through it, right? We all got to go through it. And then the preventative phase, which most people don't do, is the flossing and the taking care of the teeth. And that's like keeping the demons out. It's not hard to get them out. The hard part's keeping them out, right? That's through the renewal of the mind. That's through not taking offenses. That's through walking a holy and sanctified life. So just remember that it's not hard to get the demons out. If you repent, these things will come out. They can come out tonight. It's the keeping them out. That's that sanctified life. That's what we need to remember to do. So with that, I'll say a little prayer. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for another Thursday night, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for bringing this group of people in that are hungry to get delivered, Lord. They're hungry for a good anointed teaching tonight, Lord, and they're hungry to get delivered, Lord. Rick and I prayed earlier. We were praying for more miracles, more healings, and just testimonies to come from each night here, Lord. So we know you're going to work tonight. We know you're going to work miracles tonight. We know this teaching is already going to be anointed, Lord. We just put this whole service in your hands and we give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Testing, 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 testing. Testing, testing. Welcome, everybody. Oh, man. My eye looks funny. I have not relapsed into crack cocaine. I was rubbing my eye mountain biking in Flagstaff for about 25 minutes. I looked at myself. I said, oh, you shouldn't have done that. But I made it. I'm alive. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5 says this. This is the message that we heard from him and declare to you that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. There's sin in your life, and you say you're walking with them, and there's that shady stuff. We're lying. Greed, manipulation, lust, selfishness, building your kingdom in this world, revenge, unforgiveness, bitterness, resentment, anger and rage. Ooh, that's darkness. And then he breaks it down and he says, if you're walking in darkness, you're lying. Who are you lying to? You're lying to yourself. You're not lying to God. All things are visible before the Lord. Nothing can be hidden from his sight. You can't lie to the demons. They're the accuser of the brethren. They're watching you night and day, building a case against you as he's the accuser of the brethren, accusing us night and day before the Father. And it says this, and you do not practice the truth. It takes practice to live righteously. It takes dedication. If you don't have dedication, then you don't have any practice. I was an athlete and I saw many dudes. Man, there was this one guy, I wish I could remember his name. I was a defensive end that moved to defensive tackle. And there was this tight end, man. This dude was a smooth athlete. He never lifted weights. And he was a tight end. And he was like 6'4". 265, and I said, ooh, they're going to tell him to eat a lot and put him on the nose. He's not learning the playbook. He's not running the right routes. They can't trust him. In the Pac-10, they can't trust you on the field unless you know the plays. I said, oh, he's going to come my way. This is a raw athlete. But he wouldn't go to school. They said, we don't even want to, hey, we can't work with you. You won't go to school. You won't learn the plays. I mean, he had every bit of talent as many men that were in the NFL. He had that type of talent. 35-inch vertical jump, running a 4.7 40 at 6'4", 265. That's an athlete. But there was no dedication. Well, if you don't have any dedication, there's not going to be effective practice. So you got to dedicate yourself to the Lord. And what people get in the habit of doing is because when you first get saved, there's this incredible mercy on your life. There's this incredible opportunity for fellowship. People just come into your life. I didn't know you were a Christian. I didn't know this church was here. The church I became a member of was right down the street. I'd bounced around to 15 different churches. I was burned out with lukewarm teaching. I would read the Bible. I never went to church. I got saved, and I would say, this is it? This is your message? And I would get discouraged, and this church was right down the block, 3 blocks down the road. Once you dedicate yourself to the Lord, then God starts opening these doors. He says, I open doors that no man will open. I'll shut a door for you that no man can shut. But if you're not walking by faith with dedication, why would he open a door for you? Even if he did open the door for you, because he's merciful and kind, you'd walk right by it. Just like me, I drove by that church over and over again. And this is before the symbology and all the YouTube. There was no YouTube and all this. This is in the early 90s. And if there would have been a YouTube, then I would have Googled symbols. And they just came up with some Fruit Loop design. It was called Trinity New Life Church. A bunch of good men of God. The Holy Ghost moved there. But they had like an inverted pyramid. I would have Googled that thing and said, man, this is some kind of cult. And sure enough, many lesbians used to show up to the place thinking they saw a little insignia for them to show up. And then to be confused when everyone was families and on fire for the Lord, and it wasn't a bunch of homosexual, and this is before LGBTQ+. That's way before any of that stuff. But here it was. Once I dedicated myself, boom, I could see that door was open, and I became a member. Those guys discipled me for 15 years. They helped lay the foundation of Christ. So once you dedicate yourself, then you have to make a practice. That's how you get rid of the darkness. That's how you get rid of the discouragement, the despair, the confusion. But he says on the flip side, verse 7, if we walk in the light as he's in the light, we have fellowship with what? One another. What's the first door that gets opened up? Is fellowship. You need brothers. You need sisters in the Lord. You need encouragement. You need examples. Oh, and you also need correction. You get around people with the Holy Ghost. There's times when I was working too much when my ministry started in the prisons, and these guys will catch Holy Ghost fire. You start preaching the Holy Ghost, and a man in desperation facing life in prison, he'll surrender his life to the Lord Jesus, and they will catch Holy Ghost fire. And there's nothing to do in there but read your Bible for 5 or 6 hours a day. And I would walk in there, Lord, and I'd say, Lord, there's some things I need to clean up in my mind and in my life. Don't expose me to these guys, because they are holy now. They went from sinners, angry, resentful, bitter at everyone, hating law enforcement, hating their prosecutor, hating their public defender, and I would teach them to love them. And I would say, if you'll love them and bless them, they'll pick up your workload and they won't even know why. They'll prepare your case for you and do a good job, and they won't understand why, because the king's heart is in the Lord's hand. That represents anybody in authority over your life. He will use them even though they're not saved, and they begin to believe these things. And then what would happen was people would get favor in court cases. I met this little Guatemalan kid, couldn't even speak English. She was fresh right across the border, got picked up on a sex crime, and he got saved. He didn't even speak English. I could never talk to him directly. He had a gift I've never even heard of. He'd say, I dreamt a dream. You're not supposed to take the first deal they offer you. Don't take that deal. A better one's coming along, and it's going to be 3 years. And so guys would come to him and go, hey, man, can you dream another dream for me? And I'm like, man, I don't even see this in the Bible, but you know, let's see the fruits of it. And sure enough, he could dream dreams, and the Lord would speak to him. So the Lord would guide their case. He'll even guide you out of trouble when you deserve the wrath. Hey, the law says you go around crossing this line. You drive over 65, you get a ticket. You drive 3 times over the speed limit and get caught, you lose your license. You drive under the influence of alcohol above whatever it is, you get a DUI. So when you sign up and you know the rules and you violate them, then, hey, you reap what you sow. It says we are to obey man's law unless it contradicts God's law, and then you obey God first and you disregard man. That was your vaccines. That's where you did not trust in man. Hello, Christians were been exposed with many things. They were exposed in the debacle of these predatory loans, just thinking God was just going to keep pumping money endlessly. And they went for that. They all lost their homes, just equal with the unbelievers. Then it was exposed again, sending all your people. Oh, we can go on and on. But you got to walk in light. Otherwise, you won't see the darkness. The darkness invades. It encroaches upon you. And the Bible says, if light be in you and darkness, so it shows you that Christians can be shady. You have free will. There's nothing in your spirit, man. Your spirit, man, is all light. Holy Ghost is in there. You seal with the Holy Ghost and promise. That's a down payment that he's coming back for the purchased possession. But hey, darkness can get in your mind. Darkness can get in your flesh. A lot of times people think I'm crazy, but I just start shooting some crazy ideas to them. Sometimes it's like getting it off my chest. And as I kind of say it to an individual, I go, oh yeah, you can't do that. Oh yeah, you can't say that. Oh, vengeance is the Lord's. You got to just let that go. Hey, you got to kick in some prayer for this person so you can get disconnected from the pain in which you suffered through their betrayals. So when we walk in the light, boom, he starts leading you to fellowship. If you look at the number one problem for people in Christianity, from all my years, I sat down with over 1,000 people with one-on-one deliverances. Over 1,000, you learn a lot. Over 1,000. Over 100, you think you learn a lot. Over 200, you're getting stronger. Over 500, you got a pretty good grasp. At 1,000, you've pretty much seen it all. But you could not tell me a story of any human that you heard doing something that I have not heard personally from an individual confessing it as sin. So the first thing that the enemy does is he takes you out of the body of Christ. When you dedicate yourself to the Lord, you dedicate yourself to the church of God. You dedicate yourself to the service of God's people. You dedicate yourself to going and trying to win the lost. And people who never dedicate themselves to the body of Christ, the odds are that you're getting around a strong evangelist, strong person of encouragement, strong person of some sort of anointing to be an example to you. The odds of you getting involved with them or being around them is slim because they're in the church. They understand this verse that we're called out of the world and we're called into the body of Christ. So the minute he starts putting you in the light, he's going to lead you to fellowship. He's going to open that door. And then it says, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Verse 8, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. So what are we doing? We're working out our salvation with fear and trembling. We make mistakes. We sin, but we don't make practices of sin. This is where elementary Christian gets confused. He watches porn and says, well, I'm not under the law, but I'm under grace. Hey, I don't do it like I used to do it. I used to watch it 2 times a week. Hey, I'm only a monthly observer of pornography. But what happens is once a month is a place. Once a month becomes a habit. If you give place to the devil, he's going to root up in your life. And once he puts the root system in there, that's what's called control. At that one point of control, there's no other choice for you for deliverance. If you're understanding that you're a sinner saved by grace through faith, this isn't of yourself, it's a gift from God, and you're walking by faith and you're not walking by sight, and you mess up, the first thing the Holy Spirit does, as he's your guide in this sin-stained world, he's guiding you through your time here on earth. That's what he came for. And he guides you into the light, the truth. And then when you get off course and you sin, he convicts you of sin. But what happens if you're out of the church? Hey, people represent. I used to, when I first got my first deliverance was throwing out $50,000 worth of merchandise. And it was all legal. I sold it to professional athletes. I sold it to the Phoenix Suns. We made sculptures of a guy that was an off-the-hook artist. And one day I'm around the church. I'm in the presence of a guy who was super anointed, Brother Ludlow Walker from Southmost, Florida. Born in Jamaica, his dad was a Jewish man that impregnated his mother, and he had that Jewish DNA to get rich, and he did until God came and he gave it all up, literally. And God raised him up from nothing, from going back from owning his own hotel in the Caribbean to being a car washer with a hose, some buckets, and washing cars, hand wash, and to a pastor. Well, I'm in his presence. Well, man, I was sitting there, and I was convicted because I didn't have any joy. And I'm looking at my father-in-law, and I'm looking at Brother Ludlow Walker, and I said, Lord, I'm a minister. I help people. I'm called to do this. You've confirmed it with many witnesses that I'm called to be an evangelist. I'm called to win souls. Why don't I have any joy? And boom, the Lord speaks through the presence. First, he speaks through the church as an example. And then he says, hey, you're violating the commandment, thou shalt not make a graven image. I said, oh my goodness, I overrode my conscience. I saw the way they adorned these. I would put them up in sports bars. These athletes would put them right on their fireplace mantle. Everybody begin to adorn it like an idol. The Bible says, don't make a graven image of anything in heaven or on earth or beneath the earth. That's why we don't put Jesus on the cross. Jesus said, don't make an image of me. I'm not on the cross. He's the resurrected King of Kings, Lord of Lords. His hair is white like wool. His eyes are like fire. Out of his mouth come a double-edged sword, and the voice of it is like the sound of rushing waters, like Niagara Falls. He's got power now. He's the powerful, risen King of Kings, Lord of Lords. All victory and authority is given to the Son. And he says, I want you to worship me in spirit and in truth. And when you know the truth, then you're set at liberty. So God guides you through the truth of the church being the example of someone being free. And I got my joy back, getting rid of those idols. Sometimes it's a cost. Hey, I was like, oh man, a lot of this is on credit cards. Oh, a lot of this is worth, this is not only cost $150,000, it's worth $150,000 if we just sell it. Oh, hey, and the devil will always try to trick you. I even called up a pastor. He was kind of retiring, and I called him up the next day, and some of it's sitting in the backyard because some of it the artist owned some. And I said, hey, this is what I did. And he goes, well, if you repented of it, I don't think there'd be any problem of you going ahead and selling it and getting some of your money back. And boom, something hit me in my chest. I said, oh, he's wrong. And I said, okay, hey, I got to follow the Holy Spirit. I got to follow my conviction. I'm feeling this is wrong. I can't have an itching here to want to hear what I want to hear so I can get what I want. I got to listen to the Holy Spirit. The Word of God is written by the Holy Spirit. And so he's going to cleanse you from all sin when you walk in the light. You got to understand you have some sin, but we're working out our salvation with fear and trembling. You got to understand if you sin over time and you give place to the devil, you get demons. Any Christian that tells you that Christians can't have demons is a delusional Christian. He lives in an incubator of demons where they don't go too crazy. And if they do go too crazy, they ask him to leave the church because they don't know how to deal with them. And they tell Christians that are demonized to actually go to the doctor and get on medication. They tell him, you have mental problems, you need to go ahead and go to the doctor and take these medicines, and he'll roll the dice and start with a red and a blue, and if that won't work, they'll go to red, blue, and a green. They'll mix them around until you can be somewhat sedated where these demons don't manifest, and then you can come back. Oh, I've seen it before. I've heard it before. It's real. The kingdom of God is about power. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The devil is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He don't change. He came only to steal, kill, and destroy. He'll take your mind. He'll put a voice in your head. He'll put fear in your heart. He'll lead you astray, and you'll suffer shipwreck. Some people actually are turned over to Satan. Oh, it's real. It's real. That's real Christianity. Why? Because real Christianity is a war. Real Christianity is led by the Spirit of God that comes from the Word of God that declares that the spirit world runs the natural world. You ain't running yourself. If you think you're running yourself, well, you can't be led by the Spirit then, because it said those who are led by the Spirit, these are sons of God. So a Christian is led by the Spirit. If a person is outside of Christ, the Bible says if you're not in Christ, you have the spirit of the Antichrist. That is a spiritual force that is opposed to Christ. It's trying to put a veil on your mind so that you can't see the glory of Christ and come to repentance and get saved, that you'll be blinded from the way and the truth, that Jesus is not only Savior, he's the healer of your broken body and the deliverer from the oppression of the devil. So he'll blind the minds of those that believe not. Once you continue to sin, you are obeying spirits. The Bible says you are a slave to the one that you yield yourself unto, whether unto God or whether unto the flesh. And once the devil gets you working according to the flesh, he's going to jump in the flesh. Once he has a hold on there, anybody who watches porn will tell you, hey, it started normal. Hey, it started with Playmate of the Month. Boy, 5 years down the road, it was somewhere I never thought I'd go. It put a craving in me that actually, they'll tell you, it takes away the zeal. It only takes a couple years. They can have the most beautiful wives. They'll show me, like, look, Brother Rick, I'm not lying, man. I'm telling you, man, she's from Venezuela. I mean, look at these genetics. Look at her hair. This is just everything I ever wanted, but I can't perform. But I can only when I'm on the computer. What is this? Well, they didn't understand the spirit world. The church didn't teach them the spirit world. And I have to explain to them, you gave place to the devil. He put a hold on you. So he took what God gave you. Because what God gave you was the best, and that was to fulfill you. Her breasts were to satisfy you all the days of your life. But you rejected God's authority and God's will for your life, and you chose this. This has a power to it. It put a chain and a hold on you, and it says, now you come here to get your pleasure. And since you have to go here, you can't double dip, because the Bible says you can't serve two masters. You can't serve two. You can only serve one. And over time, you'll love the one and hate the other. So your flesh said, I hate this. What is this? Something normal and godly, undefiled. No, I want this. So it became in control. So deliverance allow you to get your control back. I'm going to talk about the three principles of deliverance that you have to understand. Unless you're doing all three principles of deliverance, you will go around and around in circles. You will be confused by the devil. If you watch YouTube, not against any of those guys, all we're on there, but if you watch that, you get an assumption of deliverance that it's some sort of one-time event. Now, everything begins with one time. A healing sometimes can happen in progress. My knee was healed in progress from bone-on-bone osteoarthritis to a brand new knee. It was in progress. God does healings, boom, like this. We love those. That's what Mike was saying. We're praying for more of those. We want to see those. There'll be no problems. People have a little problem with deliverance. But if you mix it in with some divine healings, that's an aha moment in their mind to say, hey, I need a little of that. That's real. That person rolled in here and walked out of here. So that's God. God's not confusing me. He's delivering as well as healing, because I saw that healing. I know who I brought in here with a broken body. So the enemy doesn't want you moving in the supernatural. He wants you down in this natural mind. And this natural mind, it says the carnal mind, is actually at enmity against God. There's a warfare in your flesh. Why? Because the flesh has a propensity to cry out to be served. I mean, think about it when you were a kid. When I get hungry now, I could just tap into some of these fat cells and be sufficient. I just kind of look at myself and like, oh, we got reserves to tap into. We're good. But when I was a kid, and in sports, after wrestling or after football, man, I was pretty much crazy. I've been done wrong on some business deals, and I've been pretty upset. But I'm telling you, there's some carnal anger in you. If you didn't get a good lunch and you just burned all these calories, that body's crying out, I need food. What is this barking in my house, 16 years old? Where's the food? That's the flesh has a natural desire. Well, some of it's good. It's trying to lead you to eat so you have sustenance. You're a growing individual, so you're not stunting your growth, so that you're healthy, so you can perform. It's trying to do something good, but you have to be in control of it. Hey, you're supposed to be a good lover. You're not supposed to be, oh, wow, what's that, honey? Well, where'd you buy that? Interesting. I'm going to play my video game. See you later. You're supposed to be something when you see your wife to, I'm interested in that. That's good. God gave you that. He said, be fruitful and multiply. You're supposed to have children. You have children through intimacy with your wife. It's a good thing. But it's got to be brought into subjection. And the Bible starts saying, hey, there's things we can't look at. There's things we can't touch. There's things we can't bring into this relationship. There's things we can't speak like that. We can't listen to things like that. Otherwise, that's going to infiltrate you. Once it infiltrates you, the first thing it starts doing is deteriorating the good and the perfect thing that God gave you. Oh, is this really enough? Is this really worth waiting? I mean, do you really have any marriage prospects upon the horizon? I mean, I'm kicking the tires. You know, there's some potential out there, but man, I got a burning desire. I'm ready to go now. I'm a Christian. Oh, God understands. He understands. He made me like this. I've heard Christians who are active members of the church, saved at a young age, saved in their teens, walking with the Lord, seeing God move, and I've seen them in my face say to me and Mike, why did God give me this porn demon? I looked at Mike like, have you heard anyone say something like that before? I mean, this dude looks normal. If a guy rolled up off the street and had a shopping cart or something, I'm pretty prepared for anything coming out of their mouth, and I give them grace and understanding, but not a person involved in the church, worshiping, sitting in the front row, praising God with his seven buddies, thinking that God gave him evil. Oh, God cannot be tempted with evil, nor does he tempt any man with evil, but every man is tempted by his own carnal desires. It comes right out of you. What comes out of you? Well, what comes out of you at first is, hey, I want this flesh to be served. I want this flesh to be satisfied. I want what I want. But when you don't understand the spirit world, that's where the devil puts the holds on. And what you used to want here now is down here because you gave him place. Once you're given him place, he sets up his network of holds and control. And what does he do? The first thing he does is suck your joy out. Once your joy is depleted, do you think anyone got off porn like, oh, Lord, look at the sun. What a wonderful day. I think I'll grow a garden. I'm going to go down to Walmart and get some seeds. I'm going to grow some arugula, and I'm going to get some cucumbers, a couple. I'm going to do something positive with the life you get. No, that's not how it works. The Holy Spirit comes to convict of sin, even though you've been sinning over and over again. But the devil, they can't discern good from evil because they're trying to double dip and serve two masters. So the devil jumps right in, and he comes with condemnation. There is no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus who walk not according to the flesh, but according to their faith. But you were walking when you're doing something sinful completely according to your flesh. So you're already in rebellion. You're walking out into this area without Christ. He's not going with you once you hit triple X. He's not walking down that road. He's not going to the dance club. He's not sitting there with you drinking a six-pack, chumming it up. He's not doing those things. That's called quenching the Holy Spirit. To quench the Holy Spirit was to take a rag and to wring it out of all the water. So you quench the Holy Spirit of God. We're warned numerous times in the New Testament, don't do that. He's here to help you. He's here to guide you. He's here to convict you of sin. He's then got a path to lead you to repentance. But if you don't listen to him, then you're giving place to another voice, and that voice will condemn you. So most people in addictions, in busted relationships, in sinful behavior, are riddled down with accusations of the enemy, condemnation of the enemy. So you already feel guilty, and now he's hammering you. Now you got this hold and this sway that he has over your life, and then it's like trying to ride a bike with no oil in the chain. It's grinding, you're wearing away your sprockets, the chain's being eaten away, and then pretty soon you get so tired of it, the devil goes, you know what? What does it matter if you look at it again? What does it matter? You're already having, God's taking away the joy, he's taking away the peace. Hey, what left is there? And then they go to it, and all of a sudden, everyone will tell you, whether it's weed, whether it's sexual sin, whether it's loving money. A lot of people who love money will find themselves into businesses. A strong guy was in here discipling. He says, hey, I got a good job. I was making more money than ever. I was working down at one of the rent-a-car places. But what they do is they teach us to lie, and everybody who lies makes three times the more money. They say, hey, you know what? Hey, we're out of those economy cars, but you know what? I got a couple luxury cars. Hey, what do you think about going up to a Corvette? What do you think about a Jeep this weekend? And they think they're getting a free upgrade, like, hey, you ran out of those. Hey, I'll give you a really good deal on it. No, they had all those cars. And they're just upselling. And at one point he said, hey, I can't do this for money. This isn't honest. It seemed fine because I was comparing myself, amongst my peers, amongst people who were operating according to their carnal flesh, all the way from the management, all the way down. And at first, it seemed like, hey, you should compromise. It's the way the system works. Hey, if you want to make some money, you like this money, the job already pays much better than your former job. Hey, why not succeed and just compromise? But the Holy Spirit convicted him. And then you have to follow him into repentance. That takes faith. When you had a good job, let the old job that was decent job, at least you had a job, gave that job up, can't go to back to that one to get this one. Now you got to leave this one because it's not, you don't feel right. The Holy Spirit's convicting you. Now you got to have faith. Uh-oh, and the devil's such a masterful deceiver. He'll get you with many bills and many financial obligations, and you need those checks. And he'll put pressure on you. But what you have to realize is there's no temptation given to man than which he can find the door of escape. When you find the door of escape, God always comes through and provides everything you need according to his glorious riches which are in heaven. He owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. The Bible says all the gold is his, all the silver is his. And so his command was to seek first the kingdom and all his righteousness. A lot of people seek first the kingdom because they want the blessings, they want salvation, they want health, but not all his righteousness. Oh, the Bible says he who does righteousness is righteous. Oh, yeah, he declares us righteous because his righteousness is imputed upon us when we believe. Well, then we continue to believe. We continue to believe the word of God, to hear it and do it. The Bible says the opposite. If you hear it and don't do it, you go into self-deception. That's the worst kind of deception you can go into. I got it. I look at myself and I said, oh, man, that's a bad picture, man. My body ain't built like that. Man, I lost my muscles and fat. Oh, I don't like that picture. We need a new camera. And I can just kind of check out and kind of believe that lie. I kind of want to believe it. I just kind of move on. I might eat a good meal that night to kind of work towards, you know, being healthy. But then the next day, you know, you quit and forget about it because what you glossed over, what you saw. Well, the Bible says the word of God is a mirror. It's supposed to show you not only where you're at, it's supposed to show you where you're going. So many people know where they're at. Oh, I'm saved by grace through faith. God loves me. His righteousness is imputed upon me. Well, it says all his righteousness, to love the Lord your God and his righteous ways and to be obedient to it. So that's where we're working it out now. Now we're in the world, but we're not of the world. Now we're working it out. Hey, it's fear and trembling. Why? Because I can't trust in myself. I got to trust in God. I got to acknowledge him in all my ways. Now he's starting to make my way straight. Because you'll have grace for the first 2, 3, 4 years. You get saved, and he'll just keep working through. Oh, I mean, I was in that business. I led a professional athlete to the Lord in about a $4 million house. This is in the 90s. It would be about $12 million now. And he was sitting there. I sold it to him when he was playing for the Dallas Cowboys. I showed up to San Diego, had his Ferrari in the front, but the house was all dark. He had to turn the light on. He was all alone. 13 years in the NFL. It was the first year not in the NFL. And I came in there, and he put it on his fireplace mantle, had this beautiful house, and I started preaching. And I said, you've got faith in Christ? He goes, I've been going to church, man. I'm going to this guy used to play for the San Diego Chargers. I go, he's a pastor, and I go to his church, and me and my girlfriend are going there. And I said, well, are you born again? I don't know. I said, well, when you're born again, you know. He says, these things I have written that you would know that you have eternal life. This is what he did for you. And by faith, you can receive this gift of eternal life. But what it takes is now surrendering of your life. And then he gives you a new life, and it's hidden with Christ. That means the people on the outside don't see it. I look like a normal schmo. People treat me like a normal schmo on the job site. They know I don't listen to garbage music. They know that I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't stay out late at night, I don't want to go to lunch and ramble about nonsense. But nevertheless, they don't have the Spirit of Christ, so they don't think much of me. Oh, my life with Christ is hidden. You got to be around me. You got to see me do what God's called me to do. If I'm just pumping gas, I look like the regular Joe. Hey, so I've seen women look at me, and I've seen the look like, oh, man, in your mid-50s, I think they probably warned you. Didn't they warn you a few times, like, you better get this degree or you're gonna need some money? Oh, I think driving a 2002 pickup truck just might give them the appearance. I missed the boat of education. I've seen the look before. But my life in Christ is hidden. You can't see it by the material possessions that I own. You can't see it by my deteriorating physique. You can't see it with my swollen eye because I was rubbing dirt into it. On the outside, I look like a normal Joe. My life is hidden. See, that's why when you're called out of the world into the light of Christ, you get around the body of Christ. You get around the body of believers. And then not only are you known by God, but you begin to know God. And then you begin to know one another. They begin to know you. And then there's the shaping and molding, as it says, Jesus is the potter, we're the clay. He'll shape and mold us into the person he created us to be. But then it goes into, okay, now there's some fine tuning. He's taking away some stuff out of you because he's merciful. He's beginning to move on you in a way that unless he moved on you, it would never happen for you. But as he begins to make these movements and he begins to take away some things out of his mercy and his grace, then now it says, iron will sharpen iron as one brother sharpens another brother. And you need to hear it. I need to hear it. I was talking to a guy one time, and I didn't even notice. I mean, I certainly don't say the F-bomb. I certainly don't use genital words. I certainly would never. If people use the Lord's name in vain, it's scary to me. Like, ooh, I know the verse that no one misuses the Lord God's name in vain. It goes unpunished. But I was dropping some BS, and man, these dudes are nuts. And, well, what happened? And I started thinking about it, like, well, yeah, this is true. This, I didn't even know I was saying that. He said something crazy to me. He said, have you ever dropped any cuss words while you're preaching? I'm like, bro, do I look stupid? Like, no. Well, he's like, well, man, you're kind of saying them here. I'm wondering if this is in control. Is this a demon in your life? I'm like, oh, man. Then my boss called immediately after him. And he was going off because the lockbox key was the wrong key to get in his job site. He said, I felt the windows. He went over there because it was a $750 air conditioner bill. It's only a 2,800 square foot house. He knows they got it cranked down to 72. And he said, I felt on the windows and it was cold in there. I came all the way over to turn this AC. He's cussing up a storm. And it clicked in my mind. Man, I'm around this 4 or 5 hours a day. I got to come into this situation prayed up. I got to come into this situation with my mind girded and protected because it's just they just speak venom. They just speak venom. And once you compare yourself amongst yourself, you can be deceived. That's why you can't do it. You got to compare yourself with the Word of God. And there's no well, but, and Lord, if, and one day, no. It's, Lord, I need help. Of myself, I can do nothing, but through you, I can do it. So I got to go in prepared. Otherwise, hey, I'm comparing myself. Of course, I wouldn't say these words, but pretty soon, BS, and that's a bunch of crap. And, you know, these things just came out of my normal conversation. So we need to hear it. We need to hear it from people. But if you're by yourself, then the devil's already accusing you. That's what he does night and day, accuser of the brethren. First, he accuses you, gets you to do it, or he accuses you, get to believe that it's you. Then he takes it to the Father and said, hey, I got him. I got her believing she's just a hoe. She slept with 25 men. Now she's in the church of God. She doesn't believe she can be set apart and sanctified and can be truly reborn and get a second chance. You know what? I got the right to send her another Jimmy and Johnny and Clifford, just like those guys. I want to do it again. And you know what? He gets authority over time when you believe lies. Why? Because you gave place. We're free will participants. Yes, we know Satan works with slaves, but God only works with free will participants. So if you choose to believe a lie, that lie will become your truth because you believed it. And so then he starts sending the same problems in which you fell for again. Why? Because the flesh cried out to be served. Nobody I know starts out with a sin that's painful. I've never delivered anyone from hitting their head on rocks. Now, I've delivered drug addicts through episodes of withdrawal have banged their head on rocks, but no one has an addiction to banging their head on rocks. That's a suffering manifestation of demons in their life, right? You do things that are pleasurable. The Bible says in Proverbs, sin is pleasurable, but only for a season. Then it turns on you. Every time it turns on you. And here's the scary thing when you come to the church of God, when you come to the house of God. There's people that it turned on them, and they keep going. And what happens if you don't have any discernment? They keep going with a gift that came from God. And since the person aspires to have some gifts, they want an anointing on their life. Well, the Bible says the gifts and the anointing are given without reproach. He's not going to take them back from you once he gives them to you. So a person is confused by the gift that's coming out of them, yet they're seeing shady stuff and things that aren't according to Scripture. But because they saw the anointing, they themselves want the anointing. They're already condemned. They're already accused. And so they just say, hey, we're all in this. I guess we're all like this. I got a buddy. He was, why I bring this up, he was going to a church. He just moved to Florida. He said, yeah, this girl told me about a church. He's on fire. Only been saved 2 years. I went there. Well, I wanted to see some more of his teaching. First thing I did, I pulled up the pastor's name, and sure enough, he was picked up, arrested for picking up a prostitute. Well, hey, man, unless that guy's talking deliverance, I'm out of there. I'm not going to have him lay his hands on my kids. Now, by the time you get to a prostitute, here was porn, here's many years, and here's picking up a prostitute. That don't happen in a week or two. You don't go from Playboy picking up a prostitute as a pastor rolling around in a car. I mean, that's cheap too. I mean, not trying to tell you how to pick up prostitutes, but you would think, you know, you should probably do it through a lying escort that tells you she's a model. But no, he's driving the streets, picks her up and gets busted by a regular cop or sting, whatever it was. So the point is, you have to have discernment. If you're not walking holy, if you have no desire for righteousness, if you don't have a hunger for truth, a dedication to God, then already the spirit of compromise and the spirit of blindness has come upon you, and now he'll do it to you in the church. And once he's doing it to you at home and he's doing it to you in the church, you are in trouble. And in the last days, it says, there's going to be this gathering of all these preachers. And what they're going to do, they're going to preach exactly what the people want to hear. And they're going to surround themselves with these type of teachers because their ears are crying out to be served. The ears are part of your flesh. And they want to feel fine. And they want to be encouraged. They want to be built up. There's a good pastor who's in town. And man, all the guy's trying to do is pick you up out of the miry pit and get someone saved. And he's on such a one-track thing that he can't feed the flock. So nobody can grow in there, so they only can last for 6 months to a year, and then they got to go somewhere where they can grow. But he's so focused on just trying to rescue a drug addict, trying to rescue somebody out of deception, which is true, that we got to reach those people, but sometimes those people need to look around. They need to see somebody eat some meat. You go around, I've never seen a strong vegetarian. I've never played football with a vegetarian. I never heard of them. I mean, I've never seen someone put four wheels on each side and bench press. The Paul even says that he who eats only vegetables is weak. Well, sometimes Christians are weak because they're struggling with addiction. They're struggling in poverty. And yeah, we reach those people. They're as much loved as anybody. There's neither male nor female, slave nor free. Now we can all come, you know. So, of course, we need to reach them. But sometimes they need to see somebody get strong with a strong word. Sometimes someone needs to see somebody walk around, not just focused on themselves, focused on their sins, and focus. They need to see something and say, hey, I'm going to fight for that. Like I saw Brother Ludlow Walker and my father-in-law, filled full of joy, peace in their life. Got a traveling evangelist, came all the way from Florida. They didn't even put him up in a 5-star hotel. No, he got a room at the pastor's house, and he had the biggest smile, and he sat down. He wasn't wondering where the food was. The food was coming. He was trusting in the Lord, and he was filled full of joy. Sometimes you need to see someone who's living right, feasting on the word of God, and has a joy and has power and has strength so that you can say, hey, I'm willing to fight for that. Hey, if God did that for them, hey, I'm a child of God. I need that. I need some fight in me. I need some peace in me. I need some joy in me. You know what? I need a call on my life. I need to fulfill this. Spirits are very tricky. And if you have discernment and hunger for God, oh, God will open your eyes. God is calling you into the light. You're coming out of the darkness. You're coming into the light. Once you come into the light, things are visible. Man, It's funny how I used to look at people. I said, man, bro, how do you let nose hairs grow out of your nostrils like that? I mean, you got a clippers. Why don't you just clip that too? Or they miss a chunk of their beard or their mustache, and their monobrow gets too long, odd gray. And Well, now I know because your eyes dim down and I can't see those anymore. And it happened to me now. People need to remind me. I got some reading glasses. I either got my big Bible where I look too religious when I bring it in to preach. Like, bro, did you really need to buy that big a Bible? Well, yeah, I did because either it's this or reading glasses. But to cause no confusion, I get the little Bible. But those I got to have glasses for. Well, hey, when you come into light, he gives you a spiritual vision. You need to see the reality of reaping and sowing. It's a spiritual law. No one can violate it. Whatever you sow, that's what's coming up. You can't go around with bitterness and grumbling and complaining, anxieties and fear, and think that through that is going to grow some prosperity in a ministry. It's just awaiting for that to grow up and be fruitful, and you can grab a piece and win a lot of souls. No, that's going to be bad ground, bad fruit, and it's not going to do anything for the kingdom of God. But good seed that's watered properly, adequate light, it bears good fruit. Well, that's a spiritual law. So if you're walking in darkness, you can get confused that you can double dip, that you can put certain seeds down and not suffer the effects of it. It's a spiritual law. It's just the way it works. In Ephesians chapter 6:13, after he breaks down the spiritual armor, he says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, not part of it. You're supposed to know you're saved. You're supposed to have the breastplate of righteousness, which is from Christ. You got to have truth. It's a belt that's fastened around you to hold the armor all together. You got to have your feet shod with the preparation that comes from the gospel of peace. He said the most important thing, he says, is the shield of faith. What? It can extinguish the flaming darts of the wicked one. He's going to throw them at everybody. Hey, nothing's going to turn around. Nobody cares. The more you get into ministry, hey, there's just more demonic kickback. Well, that might be true, but I'm going to go through to the other side. I'm going to break through that. That's what's called the test. That's what means perseverance. If it was easy, I wouldn't have to have perseverance. I could just go for a nice walk in the park. No, there's some resistance. So I got the shield of faith, which when the enemy is trying to come against my mind, come against my emotions, come against the prophetic word that was spoken over me, I have the shield of faith to extinguish the flaming darts of the wicked one. Then I take the sword of the Spirit. Now you get someone that's now advancing the kingdom of God. Everything else was defensive, but the only offensive weapon was the sword of the Spirit, which was the word of God. So when you preach the word of God, it'll set at liberty those who are oppressed of the devil. It will save the lost. People need to know that God has made peace with man by becoming a man, the God-man, manifested in the flesh, born through a virgin to live the perfect life you were required, which you failed, I failed, so he lived it for us. He died the death we deserved, for the wages of sin was death. So he died in our place. He shed his blood for the remission of sins. They're not temporarily covered. They are remitted. He remembers them no more. And since he rose from the dead on the third day, this will be your guarantee. One day you'll rise. And you will face Christ face to face as a believer. And you will give an account for the gifts that he gave you. You will give an account for everything that he gave as an opportunity. The word. And so since we're all going to face that day, he says we got to get prepared. So he says you take up the whole armor of God that you would be able to stand in the evil day. So that means you would stand firm. You would stand in your faith because there's going to be evil things that are going to come your way. If evil things haven't came your way yet, this is not a negative prophetic word, but it will come to you. Why? Because no servant is above his master. It says it's enough. We're like his master. And if they hated and betrayed the innocent, sinless Son of God, then they're going to betray you. That's the unfortunate reality of this insane world. The Bible even says Christ did not come to bring peace, but division. And it says a man's enemies would even be the members of his own household for his name's sake, because they chose not to believe. And therefore, they will hate you unjustly. They will accuse you falsely. They'll throw your name in the mud. But you got to use your shield of faith. Hey, I remember a guy, I thought it was ignorant, strong Christian. And I helped a buddy. This guy, me and him, would buy and sell motorcycles sometimes. We would just ride them for like 2 months. I had every Ninja, GSXR, CBR, I had them all. And I would just buy and sell them. Sometimes we'd make money. Sometimes we'd ride it for 6 months and just sell it. So me and him were bike enthusiasts. And so we'd buy and sell some bikes. I'd buy some from him. He'd buy some from me. And I had a buddy. And I said, hey, man, this guy's a good guy, man. I played football with him, man. He's a good dude. You can trust him. And then I said, yeah, he'll put it on finance. But I thought, you know, at least he'd come with half the money. He showed up with like $1,000, really nice bike. And the guy goes, well, Rick, if you're vouching for him, I'll trust him with the payments. He never made one payment. The guy calls me, and this is the point I was getting to, is he says, hey, man, I feel sorry for that guy. And I said, yeah, man, that's wrong, man. That's going to lead you nowhere. He goes, no, something bad is going to happen to him. You go around, everybody who messes with me and does things wrong, bad things happen to him. And I kind of thought, man, what ignorance. You know, what ignorance. But it was true. And, man, this guy's on a roll still 30 years later of bad things happening to him. And because he never apologized to God, I mean, he's not saved. So I'm sure the Lord put back some, you know, the complete take down of the enemy for ripping someone off for thousands of dollars. But boy, it went bad for him. He got ripped off numerous times. He's lost numerous houses. And I thought it was ignorance, but the Bible does say you're not supposed to touch the Lord's anointed. Well, what's the anointed one? His Holy Ghost comes upon you. That's the anointing of his power. And yeah, there's only one King of Kings and Lord of Lords, but we are Christians. We are like Christ, the same Holy Spirit power that Jesus did all his miracles once he was baptized with the Holy Ghost in the River Jordan. That same Holy Spirit would come upon us, and Jesus said, the same works I do, you'll do. Amen. That's real. So that anointing comes upon us, and hey, there's some people I learned, I better not get around them because some bad things could happen to them. There's some spirits that follow me, and those are just facts. They're waiting for me. And I remember Mike, I've told this story numerous times. There was a guy, I could tell he was a pretty good-looking guy. He was in his 30s, maybe early 40s. He had a beautiful wife, had a beautiful daughter, and they would wheel him in from out of, he was up from up north. They'd wheel him in. He couldn't even move the wheelchair. And he was kind of in this permanent state like this, and his face was being frozen. And we would pray for him, and it was the first person I saw we couldn't get nothing out. And the daughter would weep over him. The wife would weep. They'd stay there all night till we had no more prayers to pray for him, and nothing would happen. I said, Mike, what is that? I said, well, he was a preacher. He had a church. And he took offense. And I can't remember if it was some of his congregation or if it was some of his staff. He said he took an offense, and all of a sudden he said a Native American spirit, literally in the form of a Native American chief, appeared into his room. And he says, I'm going to help you become wealthy, and I'm going to teach you how to make wealth in real estate, and you're going to take this money so the gospel can go around the world. He went all the way over to Hawaii to buy land following the spirit. And when he obeyed him to so many places, I don't know if he followed a few business deals or if it was just once to that Hawaii deal, and the spirit jumped in him that nobody could get out. Why? And I had to think about it for a while, and then the Holy Spirit will take you through the Word of God, and the Bible says, to whom much is given, more is now required. You're required more once someone preaches the gospel to you. You are required more once you receive a divine healing. You are required of more once you get the anointing of the Holy Spirit to understand the scriptures, that there's dark and light, and that light just doesn't come upon you continually forcing its way on you. It's when you become a pursuer of the light. You become a follower of Christ. He's representative as a shepherd, meaning he's moving. He's trying to take you to the green pastures. He's trying to take you to the still waters. He's trying to take you to higher levels, but you got to be a follower. And once he followed the voice of another and he spurned the conviction of the Holy Spirit, something had the legal right to take him. And when I saw that, I said, ooh, this ain't no joke now. You start casting these demons out. I've made some mistakes. Lot's wife looked back. She longed for Sodom and Gomorrah, and she turned into a pillar of sight. I looked back, and boy, some demons were rushing me. It was like a herd of wild beasts. And boy, they ran into me, and they started changing the natural world. See, that's why a lot of people say things like, hey, you don't understand, someone's following me continually. I'm seeing the same car repetitively again and again. Hey, you don't understand, people are calling, and they're breathing into the phone. I've gotten different numbers. I've moved to different states. I've told no one where I was going on vacation, and sure enough, they were calling the hotel phone. I'm being gang stalked. I'm being I'm being looked after. I think I got a chip in my mind. I think somebody's targeted me. I'm a targeted individual. And I have to bifurcate it, because if I tell them it's all made up, it's not true. That stuff's not made up. Something is happening. Someone is calling. Something is whirly burden around. Some cars are the exact cars, and they're coming around, but it's them. It's not necessarily an organization. It's them. It's the demons. And through fear, they're trying to crack their mind. And so they're beginning to control the outside world. I met a guy, and his own words were, hey, I'm not a handsome guy. But he could fornicate with the best of them. And why? Because the devil, he was saved. And if he would give place to the devil and go into those domains, bars of the devil's domain, nightclubs, he has set those things up for unwanted pregnancies, babies out of wedlock, suicides and depression. He has a legion of spirits running those. And he said when he would go into those places, the enemy would always give him someone to fornicate with, always, over and over again. And the devil will give you the world to forfeit your soul. Some people associate what he gives you with only pleasure. But some people learn to love the misery. They learn to love the pain. They learn to operate in this confusion, and they don't hate it. They hate what's happening to them, but they don't hate it. Why? Because they've been blinded and they can't have pinpoint accuracy against them. You got to hate them. He's the author of confusion. He's the one that's waging a war against your soul. Just hating evil is good, but now it has to be intentional. I know you're doing this to me. I know you're driving me to think this way. I know you're driving me to want what God has told me not to do. I know it's you. At one point, there has to be some clear-cut intentionality for you to fight back. Paul said, hey, first thing I do is I beat down my body that my flesh would obey me. He says, I'm not beaten aimlessly as one that punches the air. I'm intentional of beating this body down that it's not telling me what to do and what not to do. I'm not going to be in fear of getting another whipping on my back, 40 lashes minus one. I'm not going to stop preaching the gospel just because they might throw me into prison again and beat me with rods. I'm going to be in control. So the first step of deliverance is you got to be delivered from yourself. If you don't have any self-discipline, how would you ever defeat the devil? If you don't have any dedication to God, if you don't have any commitment to his word, there's no self-discipline. Well, he'll give you the power to do it, but you have to discipline yourself. Paul had to do it. The greatest Christian that ever walked the planet was the Apostle Paul. There's not even been a close second to the Apostle Paul. And so he's the model. He was the chief of sinners, and he takes him from the doghouse to the penthouse as far as the fruit bearing. And boy, did he have to suffer. Did he have to go through many tribulations to enter eternal life? But he stayed faithful to the end. Why? Because he didn't trust in himself. He denied himself. And therefore, he was walking by the Spirit. That's why he could do all these supernatural things. So you got to be delivered from yourself. You got to discipline yourself. And that's the first step. If you don't have any dedication tonight and you just want us to cast out some demons, I mean, we can try it. I'm all up for it. I hate the devil, but you got to have a little hate yourself if you're going to keep him out. Why? He's a cunning and he's a masterful deceiver. He loves to put people in the merry-go-round of deliverance. You get delivered on a Thursday, doing good for a couple weeks. You had a little go, but now, hey, I'm not so satisfied because all things ain't new. My flesh isn't disciplined. Weird things, weird cravings. I got weird people coming to me and bringing in some sinful opportunities. I can't discern it. Next thing you know, you pick them up again. We'll go around now with the spirits for a while. And then after a while, you get sick of them. You know you can get some help. Rather than fighting yourself, you come on down for someone else to help you. Not against it. We got to start where we are. We got to go through what we got to go through. But at one point, you're going to have to discipline yourself so you don't pick these spirits back up. These devils don't have the power to impose their will upon you anymore when you are a new creature in Christ. It takes you yielding yourself to their will in order for them to have their way in your life. So once you dedicate yourself to the Lord, you're saying, Lord, not my will be done, but thy will be done. Wrapping it up here, you got to be delivered from yourself. Paul even said in Romans chapter 7, he said, what I'm doing, I don't understand. For what I will to do, that I don't practice. But what I hate, that I do. For the good that I will not to do, I do not do. Or the will, For the good that I will to do, I do not do, and the evil I will not to do, that I practice. He said, O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Well, he learned. Now I got to put this body to death. It's going to lead me to death spiritually and physically unless I take control over it. And Jesus Christ is the deliverer. He learned to trust in the word of God, to deny himself, but he understood he was going through what everybody has to go through. So then, if we're a new creation in Christ, we're created for good works. You have to believe that. There's a good fruit ministry. My mother-in-law was in her 50s and 60s. I went around one time. She used to have a church near Sunny Slope. She had a church van, and she used to go around and pick kids up. I said, man, has these families never heard of stranger danger? I mean, there's little kids, 3 years old and five, and they'd just be waiting out on the corner, and she'd pull up with the church van, 16 passenger, and pack these kids in. I mean, I said, I can't believe this. I mean, they're just getting in your van. Well, that was the favor of God. That was the favor of God. Many of those kids got saved. It was a little bit of a religious system. They were Mennonites. Well, they walked what they talked. Their doctrine might not have been 100 as I see it, but boy, they love God and they love people. They believe that word, so they got that love to people. And here a 50, 60-year-old lady is whipping around in a van, loading them up. Now they're married. Now they got children. And that seed was planted. Many of those grew up to be Christians of God. But it took faith. I would have said, hey, man, we don't got the... What kind of insurance you got picking up these kids? What if one of these kids slips and falls? I mean, you could have talked 80 sensible things and how no one was going to allow their kids to go in and get in some church van. I mean, where's your proof of insurance? Where's your church at? Can I get your phone number? I mean, none of that. Just go ahead. They're going to church. God opened up the doors, made a way where there was no way. Why? Because God wanted the kids. And what God wants, God will get, but he needs somebody to come into the Great Commission, to come into cooperation with his word, and he'll open a door for you that no man can open if you're about your Father's business. So we get delivered from ourselves, we become the new creatures in Christ, and then you got to be delivered from this present evil age. You got to be delivered from the world, and that's real. Some get delivered from your flesh, then you get delivered from the world, whichever way, one and two can go back and forth. Being delivered from spirits is the third thing. So you can start tonight, get delivered from spirits. You can go back and be delivered from yourself. You can be delivered from the world. You can move these in different times. You can do all three in one day, but you got to be moving in three different directions to clearly be delivered. Says this, and okay, I read that. We got to renew our mind, delivering it from this present evil age. This world's evil, and it's perishing. It's going downhill. Man, when I was raised in the 80s, we had to kick, scratch, and fight to come up with some marijuana. Now a kid, they're starting to sell it in Florida at Circle K's. I don't know. I think you got to be 21 years old, but, I mean, it's just out there. High-grade marijuana. In the 80s, this was no high-grade marijuana. There wasn't no hipsters twisting their mustache, growing marijuana in their basement with hydroponic lights and lamps. And no, this was just some stuff grown over in some third world and shipped over here. And you got a little something. This other stuff will put you into schizophrenia. The people getting schizophrenia, it's a new phenomenon. There was never any rehab centers for marijuana users. Now they're filled full of people that just were addicted to marijuana because it's so potent, it's so powerful, and it's a gateway to the spirit world. And so, the porn, could you imagine? I mean, I got an understanding of porn. I mean, you went into a porn shop in the 80s, and man, there was some creatures out there. I mean, they were driving normal cars. There was no shopping carts, no rickshaws on the back of their bikes with their recycled metal. These were normal family cars. And you'd come in there at midnight drinking, and these guys would be licking their lips. I'm like, bro, dude, what was you doing? We ain't like that. No, we're undefiled. I don't know what you're thinking. And then they're following you around. I said, ooh, that's a creeper spirit. I could put two and two together. I said, I don't think that guy could walk around with that, or he wouldn't have that minivan because wifey would have left him. He walked around that all day long, then his kids wouldn't be allowed to be with him. They'd take those kids away. Something has come upon him. I could see it. I wasn't even saved. I could tell something will come upon you go into that realm. And so we didn't try to go in there more than once every other year. We were on the play with fire because we were rebellious teenagers drinking. But boy, that was a reminder. But now, kids, it's so sedated everywhere that I read some statistic that over 50% of all junior hires sexed each other. That you're taking pictures of your genitals, sending them around to people. My son was just telling me the other day that one of his friends, he had to leave school because he was in high school, and he sexted some girl, and she showed it to everybody. And next thing you know, he was at Fellowship of Christian Athletes, and the lady said, hey, if you need prayer, if you're struggling with something, if you're having sex with your girlfriends or your boyfriends, you come to the front. And the guy goes, what's she talking about? My girlfriend lives with me. And my son goes, what, you don't know that's called fornication? He goes, nah, we're dedicated. He goes, no, you're not married. Sex out of wedlock was forbidden according to the scriptures. The guy goes, oh, man, that ain't going to happen, he said. That ain't going to happen. He just shook it off. He came to Fellowship of Christian Athletes. He wasn't in the doghouse. He didn't show up to have to get so many hours of community service. It wasn't going to give him a sparkly star with the coach because he went to Fellowship of Christian Athletes. He went there on his own, but was blinded to the truth of the Word of God. So the world is telling you one story. The world is operating according to a different program. We got to be the ones that come out of the world. And there has to be some deliverance. And then we get so trained through stimuli. I was a stimuli addict, man. We would do some stuff, man. I used to have a 1976 Dodge Duster 3-speed, and I'd drive this down out in the fields where they had moved all the railroad tracks to recycle them, so there was just a skinny little trail, not meant for a car, man. We'd blaze that thing going about 80 miles an hour, hitting chuck holes. Some of those things, you'd be up good 60, 40 foot because they have to be level as the earth is kind of contouring and moving around. It was dangerous. Well, we were just looking for highs. We were looking to push the envelope. We were trying to get that adrenaline rush. Well, everybody lives that way at some level. And then you got to sit down and be by yourself. So there comes a point where you're delivered from this world and delivered from yourself, and it goes hand in hand. And it's hard. It takes Holy Ghost power. And then once you get delivered from yourself, and there's a process that you can do it along the way, and you're getting delivered from the world, hey, then you start seeing what demons are. But if you don't deliver from yourself, you want to keep going to the bottle, you can't blame that on demons. You've already started going through deliverance. You know that it says no drunkard will enter the kingdom of heaven. It says wine is a mocker and beer is a brawler. Stiff drink is to those who are perishing. So when you start participating in any of it, you're going to start being a mocker, you're going to start fighting someone, or you're going to start dying. So you can't blame that one. You know the truth now, and you're choosing to do it. Now you have to fight back. But the flesh says, hey, I worked hard. I mean, in construction, and these dudes from the third world, man, they work hard. They're champs. I mean, they're doing what I look at them and say, man, all respect to you. I could do it for a day. I could do it if you push me for a month. But these guys keep doing it year after year. But a lot of them, boy, they crack that beer because they know, like, now I got to let the pain subside. Because work will cause you pain, especially the older you get. And they just start kicking back that drink. And so that can't be our escape from pain. That can't be our escape from I put in this hard work. That can't be our escape. There has to be a relationship with Jesus where he becomes the Prince of Peace. And hey, the closest I got to Jesus was when I was going through deliverance. And I had an extra room in my house, man. I blacked out the windows. I put some styrofoam. I went to Home Depot. I put the reflective tin foil on the backside. I taped it down. Wasn't any light. I'd go in there in the middle of the day. It'd be pitch dark. And I'd sit in there. That became my prayer room. Sometimes I'd take a nap. Sometimes I'd just sit there talking to the Lord. And he'd just build me up. Even though I was working 10 and 12-hour days and having 20 hours a week of ministry, he was building me up. He was becoming the reality of being the Prince of Peace in my life. And if you can't go to a place like that, there's resistance. There's resistance from the wicked one because he knows you'll overcome him when you become spiritually strong and you taste of the fruit that God is leading you. Some fruit you can only go as long as you've had a seed in the ground, you've watered it, and it's got adequate sustenance to grow. As you're doing the things that allow it to grow, you reap those rewards. And so that's what we got to do. And then, hey, when you're doing that, demons pop their head up, and you're like, ooh, that's nasty. If you can't see it, then a brother will see it and say, hey, man, some of your language isn't beneficial to those who are listening. hey, it's not benefiting people. We're supposed to speak only what's beneficial to those who listen, that it would benefit them according to their needs. So saying this takes away from their needs, and it's negative. So let's go ahead and make that change, and we make that change. You let a prayer out, make a request to God, and knowing that he's coming through, whatever it is. But we got to make these changes. In these last days, you can't be an isolated Christian. You can't be a keyboard Christian. You can't say, Rod Parsley was my guy in the 90s. I was like, man, he's the guy in the 90s. Boy, he'd lay it down. But it's okay. You can get a little supplement from somebody here or there. But that I said, hey, I go to these churches, and, man, they're walking around. Today we'll be talking from Psalms. I'm like, bro, at least act like you care. You're only preaching for 25 minutes. Can't you pretend for a minute so I can go into my ability to receive something? You're making it negative for me. So I would give these guys on TV, man, they're bringing it, right? And so what happened is I started stop looking for some church. But what happened is when I made that dedication and I started making a practice, boop, a door opened. And hey, I couldn't see. It was right down the street. Sometimes you're not far from your blessings. You're not far from this new opportunity. You're not far from having that quiet place with the Lord to restore, get that restorative peace. You're not that far from deliverance. A lot of times it's right there, right next to you. You just couldn't see it. So we're in the pursuit of light. Once you're in the pursuit of light, you're going to be able to see what's going on. And then pretty soon, you can see some things. There's some shifting in the world. And it started happening as people are getting set to worship the Antichrist. And we can kind of see it. He's going to be some sort of political leader to be able to unify the whole world. So he's going to have this anointing. He's even going to be able to do miracles and make these peace treaties that no one else has been able to do. But the people's hearts are already going to be primed with types and shadows. So there was types and shadows of Christ. Moses was a type and a shadow of Christ. And there's all this symbology throughout the Bible so that when Christ came, the Jews would say, well, surely through the study of the scriptures, this is the Messiah. The scriptures proved. So there's this type and shadow that's coming, and you can already see the people beginning to become deceived. And they're starting to believe lies. And it's happening at a faster pace. But if you're walking in the Spirit, you're a pursuer of light, you're dedicated, and you're around the body of Christ, you're going to be fine. That's how God works. That's a hedge of God's protection. He'll put a hedge around you. You need that. You need a hedge of protection around you because the enemy, yeah, he gets pissed when you know about deliverance. He gets pissed when you get free. He gets pissed when you start helping people get free. But you know what? When you got the hedge of the Holy Spirit, he can't do anything about it. Right. Because he was in you is greater than he was in the world. He has all power. He has all authority. He has the name that's above every name. And at the name of Jesus, demons must flee. It doesn't have to be a negotiation. It just has to be a demand. You make a legal demand on what is rightfully due you. And deliverance is the children's bread. You can be free tonight. Here's what the enemy's doing to some of you. He's saying, hey, you can be free some night, but let's not do it tonight. No, I said we do it tonight. And some will say, well, I'm not quite there. I think I need to get rid of some of my own self. Hey, you can do it tonight afterwards. You can go take some books of some people that you should never call, and you can throw them away tonight. You can X out of subscriptions, whatever it is. You can take some pipes, you can take some smoke, and you can throw it in the trash. You can do it tonight. So you can start where you are now. And if you'll speak back to the enemy, once you've repented to the Lord, once you've forgiven people, he doesn't have any authority in your life. He's trespassing on what the Lord has already purchased in full. Hey, if I got some parking tickets, I own the title deed to the car. It's my car. Now, hey, I got some infractions. I've been parking where I haven't been parking. My son does it all the time because we keep getting these in the mail to our house. That doesn't mean they own the car. They got nothing to do with the car. They're going to send that over to a debt collection. They don't have any rights to come take the car. The car belongs to us, but there's an infraction. They're putting a lien on you, the purchased possession. Hey, we got to get rid of that. How do you do it? You repent. Say, hey, no, I'm tired. I'm tired of this. I'm tired of this voice. I'm tired of depression. I'm tired of anxiety. I'm tired of fear. I'm tired of loneliness. I'm tired of nitpicking the church. So I'm fearful that they're not living right and they don't know what I know and they're not holy like I'm holy. I'm done believing these lies. I'm going to press in. And hey, when I went to church, I worked my way through the church system. One time, some guy was so happy to see me. Boy, he was salivating. Thanks for coming. And then the next day, I mean, I was a big dude. I'm 6'4", 280, and he bumps me. I'm like, you know you bumped me. It wasn't like you bumped into a, 4'11", 100-pound kid. You felt that. And it was over to shake someone else's hand. And I said, bro, you're on that do not converse with list. Later I learned the guy has just got a little cognitive disconnect. So smart that some things just don't always connect. Was fine. He had a good job. I said, that guy's a good guy. I didn't talk to him for 10 years. He was a good dude. He just made bonehead mistakes and kept me from knowing him. Why? Because I was quick to fault find. And hey, I figured if you bump me in my back, back in the day in eighth grade, boy, we'd be fighting after school for that. You should know better. You went to school, didn't you? So I had all these things in me to find fault. That's some of the deliverance. That's called pride. That's called selfish ambition. That's called self-glorification. You get rid of some of that, you can take a little bit of failures coming through some people. You can understand, hey, they're in this walk. They're trying to work out this thing. They're trying to do what God's called them to do. They're going through what they have to go through. But hey, you can be a light. The Lord will give you an opportunity. You just can't take that offense. You can't just pigeonhole everyone and size them all up. Otherwise, you've given them no opportunity. We need to get ready. Ooh, the church will help you get ready. And what do you need in a church? You need somebody that believes the Word of God. They don't believe the Word of God. That ain't for you. That's some cult. That's some kook factory. Let's not try to cook in there. You're going to come out with something wrong. So they believe the Word of God. That is authoritative, that is true, and that it's the same yesterday, today, and forever. It's for us. What he did in there for those people, he'll do it for us if we are in the same position as those people were in when they got their miracles. So you get someone that believes the Word of God and they love people. Now, it takes you a while to realize how they love people. You got to give some grace. You got to be there for a while, but you got to be able to see that person having some love for people. If they love the Word of God and they love people, you're going to be in a right position. You're going to be in a right position to grow and to be an asset to that body of Christ and to bring some light, bring some love, bring some truth, whatever God's called you to bring. But you need to be around the body of Christ in these last days because it's coming. This thing's coming. And what is it? It's nothing to fear. It's the great falling away. It says it has to happen. It'll be a sign before Jesus returns. So I want to be around the people that aren't falling away. They're not drifting away. They're rowing to the prize. They're moving in unison. They're going and working this thing out, fighting for it. So let's pray, and then let's fight. Let's take the authority. You don't have to yell at demons. You have to take the authority that God gave you over them, and you have to face them, and then you got to tell them to go. Heavenly Father, we come tonight, Lord, to your throne of grace, that we would find help and mercy in our time of need. Tonight, Lord, I need help and I need mercy. I'm sorry, Lord. I haven't been working out my salvation with fear and trembling. I've been walking aimlessly. And in return, I've suffered many failures and I've hurt some people. I'm asking for forgiveness tonight, Lord. I'm sorry for the words that I spoke, for the unfruitful things that came out of my mouth, for the unfruitful works that were done through my hands, Lord. I'm sorry of the selfish ambitions and evil intentions that I had. I'm sorry for making and giving place to the devil. Lord, I want nothing to do with this devil. I want nothing to do with his holds. I want nothing to do with his lies. I'm looking for freedom tonight, Lord, and I'm going to be able to receive it because of your mercy and your grace. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you that you hear my prayer tonight. And Lord, as you've forgiven me, I want to forgive myself. I realized that the enemy has condemned me, he's accused me, and I started to believe it, and I began to accuse and condemn myself. And so, Lord, I apologize for that. Without grace, without mercy, no one would be saved. And so that's how I start. That's how I'll finish. But I know now I need to press on. I need to forgive those who hurt me in my past. I've been wounded. I've been rejected. I've been betrayed. And so I look for any failure in a person so that I can exclude them from my life to avoid any type of further sin being done upon me. And that's not how I come into the church of God. I got to come in with mercy and I got to come in with grace. There is some discernment that comes through the Holy Spirit. I'm interested in it. But I forgive all these people in the church that let me down before, for hypocrites, for shady people. And I bless them. I bless my family. They've accused me and they've hated me at times without a cause. I forgive them and I bless them in Jesus' name. And Lord, I make a dedication tonight. Then I'm going to dedicate my life to you. In order to do that, I'm going to have to dedicate some time. And I'm going to have to dedicate some prayer, some study of the scripture, and Lord, some fellowship with the believers. And so, Lord, thank you that you opened those doors for us to be able to walk through the blessings that this thing can change. It can change fast. And I'm interested in it. I'm interested in going fully in, Lord, because I know you're coming back soon. And I want to be ready. I want to be a part of that spotless bride. So, Lord Jesus, I also need to be delivered from this world. And I'm going to start setting myself apart. Make that dedication to you. I'm going to start practicing that. And, Lord, I want to be delivered from these spirits tonight. I know it's ugly. I know it's something that's not comfortable. But, Lord, I need to confront it. There's some thoughts that continue to run through my mind. There's some desires that are working through me that are wrong, that are evil. And I need to confront them head on, Lord. I repent of drugs and porn, the occult. I repent of all of it tonight, Lord. I need to confront it. I need to get it out. And I thank you for the anointing to break that yoke, that I can walk out of here free. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If that's you, you can come on down. You can line up between that black mat and that carpet. The ministry team's prayed up. We prayed today for you that we would be able to help you. But you come and you come with a mindset of freedom. You come with that determination. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You give us this night, Lord. You've given us of your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord Jesus. This is between you and the Lord. But you got to fight. Lord, I'm going to ask for the Holy Spirit to come upon these believers that they wouldn't fight from a position of weakness, but a position of power. The power is in the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. They're going to fight from a position of power, not condemnation, not loss, not failure. Thank you, Jesus. The failure spirit, I break it in Jesus' name. Thank you for this power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit. We're going to fight from a position of power. We're going to fight from a position of authority. I'm not rejected. You've always been whispering to these women that they're less than. You've always been whispering their faults. And I bind your power in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. Oh, we take authority over you, devil, through the power of the Holy Spirit. I take authority over the spirit of the world, the spirit of disobedience. I take authority over you in the name of Jesus, and I command you, you're going to let the children of God go. You're going to let the children of God go in the name of Jesus. You're going to let the children of God go. Come out of there, choker. Come out of there right now. The spirit of the world in regret. Come out of there. Regret, sorrow, disappointment. Come out of there. Regret, sorrow, and disappointment. Come out of there. Come out of there. Take a big breath, saints. He'll come out of you. Take a big breath. Satan, I bind your power in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Come out of that man right now. Come out of all of us right now. Come out of us all right now in the name of Jesus. Come out of the back. Come out of there. Come out of there. Weed, depression, come out of this man right now. Come out of there. We're not going to sit back and just watch the Holy Spirit move. Fight, saints. Fight right now. Come out of there right now. All the regret. You told him he was a marijuana addict. You told him he was just a pervert. You're a liar. Come out. If any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. Come out of there right now. You leave in the name of Jesus Christ. Come out of there. Come out of there. Self-hatred. Suicidal thoughts. I command you to come out right now. Suicidal thoughts and self-destructive behavior. Wanting to die. Not caring about his life. Come out of there right now. in the name of Jesus. Come out of there. I'm commanding you. Come out of there. Go fight him. Come out of there. Come out of there right now. I'm commanding you. You're not going to hide in the man of God. I break these curses of word curses. I command you to come out of him now. Loneliness, come out of there right now. Suicidal thought, I command you to come out now. Come out of there. Come out of there now. Come out of there now. Go ahead, let it go. Come out of there right now. You come out of me. Come out of there. Come out of there right now. You've even lied to this man, told him he wasn't a born-again Christian. You told him his name might not even be in the book of life. You're a liar. Come out of there, you lying spirits. I bind your power to resist, separating you one from another. Come out of there right now in Jesus' holy name. There you go. Come out. Come out. Come out of there right now. Come out of there. Go. Drive him all the way out. Come out. Come out of there. Come out of there. Keep going. Come out of there. Don't stop. Come out of there. I'm not going to kill myself. Come out of there. Come out. Just take a big breath, sir. Just let it go. He's resisting you. Just take a big breath. He'll come out. He'll come right out through the breath. Go. You already forgave yourself. He wanted you to die. Let it go. You don't have to die. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for blessing this woman of God. Thank you, Jesus, for the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the Holy Spirit to heal her broken heart. Thank you, Holy Spirit, to heal her broken heart right now, Lord. All the spirits of sickness, all the spirits of disease, I take authority over you now. I'm commanding you to come out. Take a big breath. Take a big breath. Take a big breath, Mom. Take a big breath. Come out of there. Anger and rage. Don't go anywhere, saints. We'll pray for everybody. Come out of there. Anger. Come out of there right now. Anger towards preachers. Anger towards men. I command you to come out right now. That man-hater spirit, you told her not to trust men. Too many of them have betrayed her. Come out right now. Come out. You're blocking the flow of the Holy Spirit from her receiving love and receiving the word of God. I command you by the authority of Jesus. Come out of there right now. We forgive those men. We forgive those double crossers and liars. We forgive those liars in Jesus' name. We bless them. Come out of there right now. Come out of there. Come out. Let's go. Come out of there now. Go. Come out of there now. Fear. Come out. Fear of failure. Come out. Fear of getting sick. Come out of there right now. Come out. Fight him, sister. You got him. You can get him out. Come out of there right now. I break these curses of spiritual stupor. Come out of this woman of God right now. I break spiritual stupor in the name of Jesus. I break spiritualism. Come out of there right now. I break Native American spiritualism. I command you by the authority of Jesus. You told her to quit. You told her to quit praying. You told her God wasn't hearing the prayers. No, you sent the devourer to eat them up. Come out of there right now. I know you're in there. There he goes. Come out of there. I know you're in there. You're a devourer. Come out of there. Come out of there. Hey, could you grab one of those buckets? Oh, come out of there. Go. Go. Thanks. Go. Hold on to this. He's going to come out. Native American spiritualism. Come out. Come out of there. Come out of there. Come out of there, curses. Come out of there, curses and chants. Come out of there. Come out of there. Fight him. Fight him. Hey, what's the jewelry, sir? What does this mean? Oh, okay. Nothing. Nothing. Just put it in your pocket. Maybe it'll hold you back. Come out. Anger towards self. Suicidal thoughts. Come out. Come out. Come out. Evil. Evil. Come out of there. Evil. Come out of there. Come out of there. Hey, are you Native American? Come out of there. I break the generational curses of Native American spiritualism. Come out. We forgive the forefathers who conjured up spirits through Kachina dolls, through teepees, through totem poles. Come out through sweat lodges. Come out of there in Jesus' name. I break it. I break Native American spiritualism. Come out of there. I break those curses. They belong to Christ. Come out right now. Keep fighting, sister. I break these curses in Jesus' name. I break them. Come out of there right now. All that pride. Oh, I know what you do. Pride, you try to control a minister. Oh, no. Yeah, there was things he could do with his own natural talent in this world, in the workforce. But this is done through a spirit man. Come out of there right now. That pride that came in and said, if you don't do it yourself, it just won't get done. Come out. You came in through human reasoning. Come out. That does not work for the spiritual things. Come out right now. Come out of there right now. I command you to be broken off his life. That pride, his father had it. His grandfather had it. Come out right now. Come out right now. I break pride in Jesus' name. That pride will come and lead him into destruction. We renounce it in Jesus' name. Come out of there right now. Come out of there. Come out of there. Fear tells a man to hold on to his pride so it can get done in case the Holy Spirit doesn't come upon him. That's a lie. Fear, come out of there right now. Fear that he doesn't have the anointing. Fear that he doesn't have the gifting, that he's not in the shape and molding process. You come out right now. You keep luring him back to that pride, to trust in himself. Come out right now. I forgive my dad. Lord, I forgive my grandfather for letting these spirits in my life, for not teaching me when they didn't teach me, for not loving me when I needed to be loved. I forgive them in Jesus' name. Now, Satan, you're a liar. Come out of there now. Come out of there. Come out of there. Take all that party spirit, all that fornication. Come out of there. Come out. All those things he picked up in college. Come out of there. Come out of there. Come out of there. Asthma, respiratory illnesses. You come out of there right now. Come out of my mind. Keep fighting him. Keep fighting him. You've got the anointing. Lord, I'm coming against that spirit of heaviness. Spirit of heaviness tries to block. Oh, one of the most essential things in the church of God is the praying women. Oh, praying for the things that you allow them to see. Oh, this spirit of heaviness has tried to block their prayers for their family, for themselves, and even for the church of God. I break the spirit of heaviness in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. I break that spirit of heaviness right now, and I command you to let them go. Come out of their heaviness that says, don't pray. God's not hearing. Don't pray. They don't deserve it. Oh, you come out of there right now. Come out of there right now. You're overwhelming their emotions to try to block them from prayer. Oh, the prayers are coming out of the spirit, man, their inner man. You come out of there right now. I know you're choking this woman. I command you to go. Come out. You came in when she tried to find her place in the world, but there wasn't a place there for her because she was called to be yours, Lord. Come out of there right now. Fear of failure. Fear of this thing wearing off. Fear of God not showing up when she really needs him. You come out right now. Fear has to do with torment. The fear causes heaviness. I break this spirit now, and I command you in the name of Jesus Christ. Come out, every transfer spirit that came to a sweet-talking man, a womanizer. I break those spirits that came to crush her spirit and trust. I'm commanding you out now in Jesus' name. Go. Go, choker. Come out. Choker, I'm commanding you to come out. Hey, could you grab that bucket? Come out. Come out right now. Thanks, bro. Appreciate it. Hold on to this. Come out, choker. Take your poisons and bitterness. Take your poisons and bitterness. Come out. Go ahead. Let that go. Let it go. Let it go. Let it go. Come out. Oh, devil, you always do the size up game to people. You've got her sizing her up and looking at her talents and looking at her anointing. Oh, no, no, no. That's not how it works, devil. We read the scriptures. The gift comes from God. The gifts come from God. God doesn't look for talented people to use, but he gives talents unto the people in whom he called, and that is this woman of God. That is these women right here. I'm commanding you, you filthy devourer, to take your hands off these women of God. I break every word curse that was spoken over them according to their talent, according to their athletic ability, according to their intelligence, according to their beauty. I break any word curses that was trying to take or run them down. In the name of Jesus, word curses. The lack of love spirits, I command you, you're going to come out now. I break you. You're coming out now. You give her chest pressures in the nighttime. You try to lure her back to the world and say you're loved here. Are you really loved in the church? No, you're the one trying to suffocate the love of Christ. And I break your power. There he goes. I break your power. Come out of there. I break your power. Come out of there. Come out of there. I break your power. Come out of there. The spirit of the world. Come out. Come out. You cannot go where she's called to go. Come out of there. Come out of there. Come out of there. You try to put a spirit of the world in there. You always sent those sweet talkers. Come out of there right now. Come out. Transfer spirits from men. Come out now. Come out of there now. Come out of there now. Come out of there. I command you, you're going to leave. I command you, you're going to come out now. You're going to come out. Stop choking her right now. All those negative thoughts in her head, I know you're in there. Lord, I thank you that you're the Prince of Peace and the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, Lord. Therefore, we don't have to lean on our own understanding. We can acknowledge you in all our ways. Tonight, we understand you're the way to freedom. You're the way to the new life. Lord, you are that new life, the way, the truth, and the life. I bind these lying spirits that are trying to confuse them about the simplicity of Jesus Christ. I break these spirits of performance and legalism in the name of Jesus. I break this critical spirit that whispers in their ear they're not good enough in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. I come against the assassins that try to erode and deteriorate the Word of God. I bind your power now, and I command you to take your hands off. You try to use their beauty to be a lure to the world and send the world to them. Oh, no, there's been a man, and he was already made with the knowledge that that would be their helpmate. Oh, you're a liar. You've tried to send in fakes. You tried to send in phonies. You tried to send people in prematurely. And you left transfer spirits of letdowns and lies and discouragement, distraction, and despair. And I break that spirit now, and I'm commanding you to come out. Take two big breaths. Let that go. Go ahead. Let it go. You're not, you don't belong to the world. You don't belong to the world. You belong to the Lord Jesus. Oh, come out that fear that I'm not enough. The fear that God won't show up in my house when I pray to him alone in my own secret place. You are a liar. Come out right now. Fear has to do with torment. You're trying to torment them about the love of God. You put guilt in those stomachs. You put guilt in those stomachs. I command that guilt, that condemnation to come out in Jesus' name. Take a big breath. Satan, you're a liar. You told them they weren't evangelists. You told them they weren't worshipers. You told them they weren't the saints of God. You told them they didn't have a calling. You told them they didn't have a gift. You're a liar trying to take away the things that God already said they could have. I'm commanding you, fight them. I'm commanding you to come off me right now. I know you've been devouring my gifts. I know I read the Bible and you whisper, this is not for me. That's not me. You're a liar. It is me. God's not a respecter of persons. What he did for one, he'll do for all. Now come out of there right now. Fight him. Fight him. You fight now. God said you could have it. God said you could be free. You didn't have to have that guilt. You didn't have to have that less than spirit. You didn't have to live with the devourer. He said you had the power and the authority over the devil. All you had to do is use it. Take a big breath and let it go. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the spirit of discernment. Go ahead. Don't fight. He'll come right to you. There you go. Let those tears go. That's the greatest deliverance. That means you're letting the love of God in. He's coming in to show you he loves you. Just let your tears go. He says you can cast your care upon me because I care for you. Thank you, Lord. Oh, he gave him many talents, Lord. But unless they were subjected to the Holy Spirit, they would misfire. Oh, they would misfire. And if they misfire, sometimes they bear fruit because people are looking for love and they're looking for talents. But, Lord, tonight we yield ourselves to you, Lord. We yield ourselves to you, Lord, knowing that there's no double dipping. There's no double drinking of two different tables, Lord. We have to come to you, Lord. I repent tonight. Your son, I can't just rely on my talent to cover up my insecurities and fears and my failures. I want to be a transparent and an honest man that whatever I do has been done through Christ. So I'm coming into light tonight. I'm sorry for my sin. I'm sorry for the sin that I didn't hate and I didn't fight it. That's the one that keeps creeping back up. I wipe it off the table, but it keeps finding itself right on my table again and again. Tonight, I repent of it in Jesus' name. It's time I go all the way in. It's tonight I fight this devil. I know you came down. I saw you in my dad. I saw you in my granddad. I seen you in my family, and I don't want nothing to do with you. And tonight, I'm going to do something about it. I fight you in the name of Jesus Christ. Come out of there. I forgive coaches. I forgive people that wouldn't help me when I needed help. They gave up on me when I was actually looking for help. They were done with me. I forgive them in Jesus' name. I forgive my dad. I forgive church people who look at me like I don't know if I can trust them. I forgive them in Jesus' name. You're going to be the one to raise me up, Lord. Well, I'm humbling myself under your mighty hand tonight that you could exalt me in due time. Just let your tears go. That's one of the most powerful deliverances. Oh, he's breaking you in a good way. He's taking away that old man. He's taking away that old man in Jesus' name. The weed, any of that worldly hip-hop, any of that rap jingle that was prayed into his heart, it comes out tonight. That comes out tonight. That hardness, that rebellion, it comes out tonight. It comes out tonight. There you go. There he goes. Come out of there. Come out of there. That hardness comes out. It was a defense mechanism so nobody could get close. Come out right now. Just let it go. Go, devil. Go. Now you come out, devil. Now you come out. All the way. Come out, evil. Come out, curses. Come out. I break generational curses now. I break generational curses. Come out now. Come out, anger. hatred towards people. Come out right now. Vengeance is the Lord's. The Lord will repay them. You just forgive them. Come out. Come out. I'm tired of this anger. I'm tired of this rage. You're coming out now. Come out. Out of that chest. Come out of there. What do you need to be delivered from, sir? Keep going till you're all the way free. You sick in your body? What addictions are you? What are you addicted to? Is that your wife? You got someone like that? What? You can't see God's got a call on your life? If he didn't send that ambassador, that helpmate to you, you'd have been a long gone like your other 10 friends that already came and gone. He's got a call for your life. He said there might be pain in the night, but joy would come in the morning. You got to go through some pain sometimes to appreciate the light and the peace. Lord, tonight, what's your first name? Albert? Lord, tonight we repent. Me and Albert. We can't serve two masters, Lord. You sent him this wife to love him when he was unlovable. That was Christ in her. Oh, Lord, he could have been dead and gone. Somebody couldn't have showed up with the Narcan. But, Lord, you kept coming for him. Why? Because you love him. Oh, the love of God is where the power is. That's where the mercy is. That's where the forgiveness is. That's where the second chance is. Lord, we come in by faith tonight into your presence for my brother to be free. Oh, Lord, he can be free from himself. Tonight, we don't hate ourselves. Tonight, we stop letting the devil talk to us. There is a second chance with Christ. This wife is a representation of there's always been a second chance right next to him. Tonight, we come into light and we see that you are good, Lord, and you won't stop. You won't stop loving us. But, Lord, we want to be willing recipients of your love tonight. I reject this spirit. They even tried to throw hepatitis on him. They told him it was a lifelong illness. I say you're a liar in Jesus' name. I bind you. I bind your opioid addiction. I bind that tweaker spirit that made him angry and rebellious and a thief and a liar. Blaming everybody else. Tonight, we own up. We face up and say, tonight, we repent of our sins. And we thank you that you forgive him tonight. We thank you for the precious blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses him from this guilt and shame, from this condemnation. Thank you, Jesus. Now, Satan, come out of there. Come out. He shall live and not die. Come out of there right now. He shall live and not die. I bind the spirit of death right now. The spirit of needles. I bind your power right now. The spirit of suicide. The spirit of murder. Come out of there right now in Jesus' name. Come out of there. Come out of there now. Come out of there, poisons. Come out of there. I take authority over you and break you in the name of Jesus. I break you. Come out of that body. Come out of that back. Come out of that body and back. Come out of there. Fight him. Fight him in Jesus' name. Come out of there. I'm not going down with kidney disease. I'm not going down with liver failure. I'm coming against you in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. I'm not going to rebel against my wife. I'm not going to spurn the blessings of God. I'm going to let them come, devil, and you ain't going to stop it. And deliverance is my first one I'm getting tonight. Come out of there, free from you, evil. Come out of there. Fight him. Fight him. Come out of there right now. Yell at him. I'm done with your needles. You told me I was just a junkie. You told me this was my portion in life. You even said God don't love me, but my eyes are open tonight to know he does. Come out of there, evil. I break this curse over my own life. I break the curse of failure over my own life. You told me I couldn't get a job. You told me I had attention deficit disorder. I couldn't press through. You're a liar. Come out. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Come out of there. Come out of that back. Come out of that back. Back pain, starting with opioids, getting off the opioids, having a hurt back, having to get on the pharmaceuticals. I know what you've been doing to him, and it stops now. Come out now. Come out of there. Get him till he fights out. You know where he is. You know, get him out of your arms. Get him out of your arms. Get those needles out of your arm. Keep going. Thanks. Just tell those spirits, take your hands off my husband. I fought for him in prayer. The answer comes tonight. Freedom is in Christ. Now come out now. Come out of there, infirmity. Come out of there. She's going through deliverance. You told her she was a hard case. You told her she had a terrible life. You told her just to be a victim. You told her to bring it on into the deliverance center and just be a victim. No, tonight she's more than a conqueror through Christ who gives her the strength to be healed. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for these women. Thank you for these women. We're asking you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. We're asking for the Holy Ghost anointing. Lord, to come on down, Lord, where we've been hard and we've been rebellious and we've been stiff-necked and, Lord, we've been hard of hearing. Lord Jesus, I'm asking for the anointing to come down. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. I forgive men that curse me. I forgive men that abuse me. I forgive people that chewed me up and spit me out like I was nothing to them. I forgive them in Jesus' name. But I declare tonight I shall be healed. Tonight I shall be delivered. Tonight I shall be restored. Tonight my mind shall be renewed. You come out right now. You've been choking me. Come out. He's right there. Come out of there in Jesus' name. Come out of there. Come out of there. You ever had any encounters with Jesus? You ever had any encounters with Jesus Christ? Fight him, sister. Huh? Oh, praise God. And you had some encounters with Jesus? You met him? Oh, amen. Oh, amen. Oh, yeah. And so now you need to be healed? What's going on tonight?
Oh. And then I also I think I have cancer.
Oh.
And I also have Parkinson's
disease. Oh. How old are you?
80.
80?
Yeah.
You want to live? You want to be healthy and finish strong until the Lord calls you home? What's your first name? Carol. Heavenly Father, I got Sister Carol here, Lord. Thank you for that Baptist church who preached the glorious good news of your word. Thank you for those saints that you sent to help her grow as a woman of God. Tonight, Lord, we realize that chemo can come back, cancer through chemo. We understand that, Lord, you're the great physician. Tonight, I'm asking to heal Sister Carol's body. I'm asking to heal her mind so her memory comes back through her passion so she can pray for this lost world. She can pray for the church of God. She can worship you, Lord, until you call her home. She can share the good news of Jesus Christ. Lord, she says she wants to live, Lord. In order to live, she needs her mind back, her joy back. I'm asking to heal her, Lord. Healing power, come into Carol's life. Healing power, overtake the mind, the central nervous system, the organs, the regenerative process, Lord. Let it be loosed upon her, Lord. You are the healer, Lord Jesus. Heal her mind. Now just stand up, Carol. Stand up. Stretch yourself out. Ready? Stand on up. Come on up. Now just stretch yourself out a little bit. Just go ahead and receive a healing. Go ahead, just receive it. Lord, I want my body to work. I need to be strong for my sons. I want to go back to church and sing some songs. Just tell them what you want. Lord, I'm praying pain would leave these shoulders. Pain would leave this back. Lord, that the healing power would come into this back. Lord, thank you that you're restoring her memory, that she can get back into that scripture and hear the glorious good news of your truth and your love for not only her, but for the world, so that she can believe, Lord, for this lost world, and she can pray for it according to your will and your word that's revealed in the scriptures. Thank you for giving her strength. Just receive it. Sing a little song to the Lord. Go ahead, one of those old songs. Go ahead. Before you go, you sing to the Lord. Don't leave. And you sing a song to him. Sometimes you got to praise your way into the miracle. Sometimes you got to praise your way into the miracle. Lord, tonight I praise you, Lord. I used to curse you, but now I praise you. I used to hang around the sinners and sit in the seat of the scornful. I used to get counsel from the mockers. But tonight my delight is in the law of the Lord, Lord. Tonight I praise you. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to get up in the morning and I'm going to praise you. I don't care about detox. I'm going to praise you. I don't care if I got to start with a job moving boxes and my body's got to be healed along the way. I'm going to do everything with gratitude. I'm no longer a victim. You told this man he was a victim. Ah, no, not when Christ comes. You become victorious. You become victorious in Christ Jesus. Come out of there. Come out of there. Come out of there. I bind your power. Curses from gangs. Curses from cheating. Curses from hurting people. Curses from robbing. Come out of the people of God. Come out of there. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, did you ever have a boyfriend really break your heart when you were a young girl? What was his first name?
Diego.
Diego, did you ever forgive him?
You found unclean spirits, let her go.
Yeah.
Let her go now.
Well, what happens is a lot of times when you love someone, it's supposed to go two ways. And then it goes on to marriage, and the two become one flesh. But if you start going further and someone breaks it off, a part of you can go with them. So let's just pray this prayer. Tonight, Lord, we forgive Diego. And Lord, we know that our hearts are not broken. That you restore our hearts, you restore our dreams, you restore our faith, Lord, in finding a husband, someone that will love me and be the father of my children. Lord, I forgive him right now. I forgive him for his lack of commitment, his lies, any persistence upon pushing my comfort and boundaries and conviction. I forgive him in Jesus' name. I forgive him, Lord. You said that when I find a husband, I'll find a good thing and favor from you. I don't lose any faith that that's going to happen for me. But I let him go. I let him go right now in Jesus' name. Take a nice big breath. Come out of there. That pain from a busted relationship of love, whether it was Diego, whether it was men in the past, that pain and that lack of faith and lack of trust in men, I break it in the name of Jesus. I break it in the name of Jesus. I break these worldly amusements that came upon her. I break the worldly entanglements to tie in her emotions. In the name of Jesus, I bind that spirit who even lied, said, why did God do that to me? Why did he lead me into that only to have my heart broken? Oh, I let it all go now. I let it all go in Jesus' name. These lies that were put into her mind because of her beauty. You told her value was in her beauty. Her value was in her sexual character. I say, devil, that's a lie. That's a lie. Her value is in the inner woman. And who she really is in her heart. I break that spirit of the world. I know you sit right there and you accuse women of God. I break it right now in the name of Jesus. Come out of there. Fear of failure. Fear of living a subpar life. You whispered to her and said a mediocre life in a mediocre neighborhood with a mediocre church would be a failed life. You're a liar. You've accused even the truth of God and the path of God so that she wouldn't see it when it came her way. You're a liar. Now come out of there in Jesus' name. Come out of there. Just take... You for years, just let it go. That's all you got to do is let it go. The Holy Ghost is on you. Go ahead, let that stuff go. He's here to help you. He's here to help you. He's here to help you. The Holy Ghost is the helper. He'll help everybody. When does he show up? In your time of need. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit, showing up for the women of God. Thank you for showing up for the men of God in our time of need. Lord, we need to get prepared. We need to study. We need to show ourselves approved. We need to take on the mindset of a workman, not needing to be ashamed, able to rightfully divide the word of truth. Thank you, Lord. And as we divide it, we follow it, and we know it, and it becomes our freedom. Come out of there right now. Come out of there. I come against rejection. Rejection, you've tried to attach yourself to this woman when she was only 4 years old. That's the first time she had the wake-up call that not everybody loved her. And there was a sense of fear that came upon her. I break it in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. Fear, you've been tormenting her. You've tried to get her to run away from God, run away from truth. Afraid if that failed, what would there be left? You're a liar. Come out of there. Fear in the name of Jesus. Torment in the name of Jesus. I command you to come out. I command you to come out of the inner man. Come out right now. Come out of the inner man. Come out right now. Fear that she won't find a husband. Fear that she won't have a good career. Fear that she won't have a place in the church of God. Come out of there right now. Take a big breath. Come out of there, devil. Stop stalling in the woman of God. Stop stalling. In you. I'm commanding you. Fight him. He'll come right out of you. If you'll fight him, church. If you'll fight him, church. Lies. Come out of there in Jesus' name. You're a liar. You don't. He's got you living in lies. You've repented of those lies. Stop believing his lies right now. He's trying to tell you it's going to be a long process. He's telling you you don't deserve to be delivered because you willfully sin for a long period of time. Come out of there. He's a liar. That's who you're fighting. You're fighting lies. Oh, if you've been watching this streamers and you haven't received any deliverance, it's still available. Don't lose faith here. It's lies have stopped you. Lies always have a rhyme and a reason, and it always is based in performance. The Bible says, what are the works required to inherit eternal life? The works required was to believe on the one in whom God has sent. You have to believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. You have to believe that he was slain before the foundation of the earth on the cross of Calvary. And when the blood was shed for the remission of your sins, so a guilty person could go free. Oh, and then as you're in Christ, we're in Christ. You would not have been on this stream. You wouldn't have stayed in this building if you weren't in Christ. So now that you're in Christ by faith, deliverance is the children's bread. He said you could partake of it. He said you could experience it. He said you could have it. You can have it tonight. You can have it to another level. You can have it. But sometimes you have to get nasty. You don't have to yell at them with your lips. You don't have to pound on things, but you have to get serious and you have to yell at him in your mind. Satan, I hate your guts. I know you've been making me sick. I know you broke my finances. I know you misled me. I know who you are. I know who you are. I know who you are. I'm tired of you in my life. Yell at him in your mind. I hate your guts. You wanted me to be a carnal, lukewarm Christian. You wanted me to be a fake down the road so that you could get me to quit. You could get me to walk away from the church. You gave me a no-love spirit so I wouldn't have compassion. And I wouldn't have a love that I could love the unlovable, but I would only love those who love me. I know who you are. I can see what you've been doing in my life. And I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of my life. Streamers, take a few big breaths. All you have to do is take a few big breaths. Come out of there right now. He tried to tell you to quit. He tried to tell you lies about how it works. Oh, I read the scriptures to you. You got to believe the scriptures rather than the voice of the enemy. He tried to say if God wanted to deliver you, he would have already done it. He tried to tell you that, hey, don't try to fight demons. Just wait till the Holy Spirit comes upon you to deliver you. Well, I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit is here now, and he's willing to help you now. You just have to want it. You go ahead and take it by force. The kingdom of God suffers violence, and the violent will take it by force. He's violently trying to oppose the word of God in your life. He's violently trying to oppose the blessings in your life. He's violently trying to oppose the peace coming in your life. You have to fight back. He is the one doing it. He is the one doing it. Satan, take your hands off me in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. Sometimes you got to let your tongues roll. You got to fight back. You got to use your faith. You got to use your faith. You got to fight back in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. If you need to be healed, oh, he's the healer. All you got to ask is for a download of the healing power. Ask them to come on down to your joints and your organs. Ask them for the healing power to come upon my brittle bones. Oh, let the healing power come upon my body. Thank you, Jesus. Let the healing power come. Oh, thank you for the healing power to restore her emotions. Oh, thank you. Restoring her emotions in Jesus' name. Thank you for the healing power. The healing power that makes all things new. Thank you, Jesus, for the healing power. That's one of the attributes of us as a believer, that we would lay hands on the sick and the sick would recover. That means there's a flow in the believer's life to see people healed. How is it done? It's done by faith. Faith in you, the healer, as he is in us, is greater than he who is in the world. Thank you, Jesus, for healing their minds and emotions. Thank you for healing their bodies tonight. Thank you that these young men get healed. Thank you for healing. Thank you for healing of their minds. They were told they had attention deficit disorder. Thank you for the healing and the patience that comes upon their mind. Thank you, Jesus.
Loose.
Thank
Sam,
you, Jesus.
Come out in the name of
Sam,
Jesus.
You're
come
a liar.
Out.
Let's go.
Come out, Sam.
Let's go. Come out. Let's go.
Come out of there.
You're coming off the spine. We come against you. We come against you. Come out of there. We come against you.
witchcraft over her brain right now.
Shandaraba Korreme. De la Korama Mama Soto Korre. You rise us up out of the mire pit of deception. Thank you that you're taking us out of deception and putting this woman on solid ground. Thank you for the healing, healing her mind. Thank you for healing. The spirit of rebellion. Rebellion. Oh, you started marking her up. Oh, the new marker. Come out of there. You said, these are your new marks. Nope. In the name of Jesus. Oh, it was the blood of Jesus. Go ahead, saints. Praise your way out of there. Thank him tonight before you go home. Thank him tonight before you go home. Thank you for delivering me. Thank you for helping me. All poisons come out of the lymphatic system. All poisons come out of the poison of bitterness, the poison of self-destructive behavior, the poison of womenizing. All poisons leave tonight. All poisons leave the lymphatic system, the organ system. Oh, we will not be the ones with bitter gall inside of us. Not tonight. Not anymore. Not tonight. Go ahead, saints. Praise your way out before we all go home. Thank the Lord for what he did. If you don't have a song, you can just open up your heart. Share what's in your heart. Thank you for the gratitude, Lord. Half the deliverance is being able to do something you couldn't do before. Receiving some deliverance tonight will allow you to do some things. Start with the gratefulness. Amen. Need some prayer before we go? Thank you for this woman of God, that she's not a victim. You try to tell her she was a victim, and therefore you put her on the merry-go-round of deliverance. We come against the lie that she's cursed. You cannot curse what the Lord has blessed. Whenever the Lord begins something, he always promises that he'll bring it to completion. These are facts we stand on, devil. That he was in us is greater than he was in the world. He is greater than all witchcraft. He defeated witchcraft on the cross of Calvary. He defeated all principalities and powers. Oh, and the train of his robe fills the temple. Oh, he stripped the enemy of his robe, of his royalty, of his position. Oh, the conquering king took it all on the cross of Calvary. We are now victorious through him and his finished work. Oh, he's having his full way. You just got to thank him for it before you go home. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want a different heart tonight. I want one that can go home with gratitude. I want one that can go home with some praise. Lord, I've had inhibitions. I've had insecurities about my praise. I've had insecurities about my speaking ability, about my ability to articulate the gospel. Tonight, I want to receive what you've called me to do by faith. I receive that gift that was deposited in me when I first believed. The Holy Spirit gift that came into my heart, into my spirit, man. I receive that gift to be a light to the drug-addicted world of my community. I receive that light of Christ to go and love people. To go and love people. It's over. You told him to be a murderer. You told him to be a killer. I come against your heavy metal curses. Get him out. You're not a killer. You're not a murderer. He tried to get you to do it in your heart and with your words first. Oh, then he was going to come and put a weapon in your hand. That normally comes decades later. No. No. Molestation, come out of that man. You came in through some molestation and some fondling. I come against it in Jesus' name. We face it tonight. You told him he was broken and busted because of what somebody did to him. No, I say, devil, you're broken and busted tonight. You're exposed. Come out of him right now. You're not a victim anymore, sir. That was done when you were a child. You're a man of God now. You can drive out that accuser. He whispered how small you were, and because you were young, it seemed reasonable. But now you became a man, and you put away the childish things, the childhood assassinations in which he assassinated you. It's over now. You care about God, he cares about you. You love him because he first loved you. He's helping you. He's helping you. Go ahead and let your praise go, saints. You praise your way out of here. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. You've always sent people who love me, Lord. I'm sorry for not loving them back. I'm sorry for not seeing they were sent by you. Lord, I'm asking for strength to come into my friend so that when he goes home, that he knows what you start, you'll finish. Thank you for strength. Let's take a big breath. That's in your emotions. Just receive strength into your inner man. Go ahead. Just take a big breath. I forgive the man that molested me. I forgive. I'm not that abused man. I won't do that to nobody. I stop it.
I stop.
Now take a big breath. Holy Spirit, come in. Now fear, go. Fear that he'll do something that he doesn't want to do, come out. Fear, come out. Fear that he'll be who did whatever was done to him, that he would be that man. Go. 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 Go, molestation. You've been exposed. Go. 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 Just get it. He'll go. Once you know you're not him, he goes. Once you know you're not his, he goes. He goes tonight. He goes tonight. He goes. You faced him. He goes, saints, because you faced him. You faced him. That's why he has to go. You faced him. And you said no. You stood your ground. You stood on the promises. Thank you, Lord, that I had faith to preach, even though my eye looked like a smashed eye. Thank you, Lord, that you showed up to touch all these people. Thank you that you always showed up to the Arizona Deliverance Center. Oh, I bless every person that prayed for tonight's service. All saints at home, it meant something. It brought some impact tonight. Oh, it was of much value and much appreciation from us. Thank you for your prayers. I bless these streamers. Some fell asleep, Lord. I pray their sleep would be sweeter than ever. I pray that recovery and healing would even happen in the time of rest. Thank you, Jesus. We love you for what you did. We love you for who you are. We bless you. We bless anybody who cursed us and wished us ill will. We bless you. Amen.